living church. Does that make sense to you guys? This is why it's written, and it's so important that you remember this, that you don't forsake the assembling of yourselves together, as some do. Why? Because you are a part of the body, and when you're not here, the body suffers, right? You also, as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house, a holy what?
Priesthood.
You ever thought about yourselves as priests? Yeah. Do you realize it's one of the gifts that Christ gave you? Do you realize that before Christ, if you wanted to offer a sacrifice to God, you had to go where? To the temple, right? And when you went to the temple, who did you give your sacrifice to? And the priest took your sacrifice, and the priest ministered your sacrifice to God. You don't have to do that now. You're able to go to God yourselves. Do you understand that that blew the mind of the Jews? And they couldn't deal with that? Those who accepted it and understood it and got it realized what that meant. Others who rejected it, because they could not see us being able to go to God directly. Do you understand the freedom that you have in Jesus Christ? Do you realize that's one of the freedoms that's written in the New Testament that people argue about now we just have the freedom to eat anything, do anything, and live any way we want? But the freedom that you're talking about there is a freedom to approach God by yourself, because you are a holy priesthood. God has made you kings and priests, and that includes male and female. Holy priesthood, to offer up what kind of sacrifices?
Spiritual.
What does that mean? What are the spiritual sacrifices that you have been called to offer up? Ourselves, that's a good answer. Ourselves. Is that the only answer? You guys have any other thoughts on that? What are the spiritual sacrifices? Let me ask you a question. What kind of sacrifices are they talking about? Blood sacrifices, like the animal sacrifices? What does that word sacrifice mean? When you hear it, what does it mean?
Give up. Change away.
It means that it's something that's going to cost you something. It's a sacrifice, right? So you offer spiritual sacrifice. Linda, you got your hand up?
Give up our earthly gods.
Okay, I like that. Listen, I want you to understand this in the thought of a first century Christian who prior to this time was used to going to the temple, having a priest take care of all this. That you brought your animal, you took the blood of that animal, and the priest ministered that blood so that your sins could be forgiven, right? And so now you're told that your body is the temple of God, and that you offer the sacrifices, spiritual sacrifices. Jesus, at one point in his ministry, told the people, and we went over this in race and sacrifice class, you must drink my blood and eat my flesh. And from that day, a lot of his disciples walked away from him. But when he said his blood and his flesh, he told them clearly that his words were spiritual. Right? Spiritual. Spiritual. So we are to offer up spiritual sacrifices. What does that mean? I like that. The word I'm looking for is that you have now got to make the decision of whether you will totally surrender everything to God and offer up that spiritual sacrifice, where you no longer run your life, but you allow Him to run it for you. How easy is that to say, but how hard is that to do? How easy is it to say, I'm doing that, and you find yourself, you're the one that's actually running it? Okay. All right. Whenever am I on? Okay. To offer up spiritual sacrifices, acceptable to God by who? Jesus Christ, right now in the sanctuary in heaven, is your what? He's your intercessor, but he's also what? Starts with an H, somebody just said it.
High priest.
High priest, right? And isn't the high priest the one, or the priest the one that offers the sacrifice, makes the atonement? So you offer up your spiritual sacrifices. Instead of bringing an animal, you bring yourself. And you allow your flesh to be poured out, crucified, and you now have been made to live in the Spirit, right? And all that means is now that you live for God, and that God lives in you, and that the works that you do are works that are brought about by God living, right? Okay, wherefore, also, it is contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, that's Jesus Christ, elect, precious, and he that believes on him shall not be what? What's that word there mean? Confounded.
Confused.
What's that? What else? Bewildered. When you build on Christ, you can be sure and be positive that you are building on a firm foundation, and that nothing can shake you from him except yourself. Right? Okay, I'll go through one more and then we'll stop. Unto you therefore which believe, he is what?
Precious.
Precious. But unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner. Now, Daniel interpreted a dream. A king had a dream of a statue. The statue was made out of many precious metals. The head was of gold. The feet were of what?
Iron
and clay. Right? And at the end of this dream, he saw a rock smash into this statue. Right? This rock. This rock that he saw is this chief cornerstone. Those that believe shall not be confounded. Those that are disobedient. Where's that word at?
Not there, right?
Them which be disobedient, this stone, which the builders disallowed or rejected, the same is made the head of the corner, and a stone of stumbling, and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto they also were pointed. When Jesus comes again, and all this is wrapped up, there will be no excuse for being lost. You guys understand that? The ones that are lost because they chose to be lost. They chose to be disobedient. They chose to reject the chief cornerstone. And because they chose to reject him, they do not want to live with him throughout eternity, and God will give them the desire of their hearts.
Perfect.
No matter which way.
Mercy.
That is merciful. Closing hymn this morning is hymn number 526.